stay in tours because we have the most incredible panel here. Thank you for coming, and thank you, Dave DeRoche, for organizing this star session.
Welcome our speakers, we welcome all of you. We're going to move quickly because the idea of this is a visual feast where you're going to see some great examples of art, and everybody says, how can you do this in such a short period of time? Well, first of all, Sam Singer, our co-moderator here, suggested that I hold the clicker. And he also gave me 10 cups of coffee. Then I made sure that everybody on our panel has ADD, and for Sam's sake, I withheld his medication all week. So here we go, and we're going to start with some photographs of... There we go. Chris Boylan will speak to us about shields. Chris Boylan came all the way from Australia to speak to us, and... He shows shields and loves shields. He's a dealer. He has a booth at the show. And he's got the great aesthetic. And go ahead.
Excuse me, I'll put my glasses up. Give my sunglasses. The slide. This is an introduction. Is this working out there? Just as an introduction, a couple of general comments. We're talking about the aesthetics of tribal art, and it's very much, until more recent days, a Eurocentric conception. You can see the early collections, were collected from the 1750s onwards, came back to Europe, and by and large entered private collections. And gradually over the next 100 years or two, museums were formed. And there's, in terms of private collections, there are very large collections, some in America, some in Australia, where a house might be filled with pieces. But in many private collections, they're much smaller than their tribal collection, and they're combined with the country art. And shields are in some ways on the fringe of this. I'd like to say, can we just go back to the first one? The coastal shields tend to be very anthropomorphic. They use faces and a lot of quite beautiful designs around the faces, animals. You can move along to quickly get a detail, another face. And the faces on these shields are very much related to the other cultural parts of each cultural group. Moving inland, the pieces, and this is a general comment, as you move inland away from the coast, the shields become more abstract. This is a Roman group shield in the W. Miller collection. It's showing the size of the shield, and it's often good to see people holding these. You can see that it doesn't cover the whole body, it's usually half the body, and that's very much the way shields are used.
And so we have the person behind there.
We do that. Wonderful. It has an amazing variety of shields. two of us flying out of the shield. This is a wonderful field. You mentioned the warrior moving towards the shield. But the this is much more my favorite. It becomes more abstract and similar. It relates to some of the animals that you find in the much more abstract, and again, further away from the coast. The wonderful shield collection in Sydney, the Green River Shield, and here the design is becoming even more abstract.
Is there a certain thing that it starts with, that it's abstracted from? Is it nature, or...?
It's always comes back to nature, yes. Or to man and the human body. One of my favorite shields. This is a Boylan collection here in Turkey. It is a photo by Barry Gray, who's studying the Star Mountains, and it shows again the size of that field, quite large, and it gives you an impression of how people would use it, hiding behind the shield. Wonderful field from 3D collection, one of the earliest collected in public domain. And all that is left of it, color is going to be painted originally, but it's like burnt designs. Brown and red. Now the next photo will give you an impression of how the shield will be looking at it. One photograph taken about 1933, 1934, others, the first people. And soon after the photo was taken, all those shields were burnt. Now this is one thing about shields as art objects, that the colonial people who came in, you know, one of the first things they wanted to do was stop warfare. In many cases, these were the things that were burnt. Shields, the weapons were taken off, which were burnt. And it's one reason that we don't see so many shields in collections.
So you might say that collectors are actually heroes because they can so figure
formed in the middle, but on one side, put in the arm totally disappears at the top, and the and only becomes a very simple line. It's something you can sit down and look at the shield over and over again. The eye part just finds a wonderful design to the shield. Similar shield taken in the field, but a very similar figure. Wonderful image of a moving figure across the shield. I mean, why on earth that would happen, I don't know, but it was a wonderful, wonderful image. This is a shield from the Queensland University Museum, collected 1884. Wonderful figure of peace. And the next one, another copper gold shield. And just to comment, the Solomon Island shields are the really only figure of shields. And the shape and the fact that figure relate, it would seem to be copper gold shields in the southwest. And the final shield, just showing an Aboriginal shield.
Thank you. Come from Hawaii, although you were last in New Zealand
a few days ago.
He's a frequent flyer, and here is Mark.
All right, well, before I start, I want to say that I just shot a documentary film in New Zealand, Chris and Puss, with my mentor, David Simmons, who sadly passed away at the end of November. And on that note, I want to say something that most people that even know me don't really understand. I'm in a very fortunate position that I was mentored by many, many important artists. First and foremost, probably Adrian Kepler, who's my adopted mother. Okay? And then the list goes on. H.P. Skinner, when I was a kid. Terence Farrell, my adopted father. Roger Leach, Thor Heyerdahl, who I knew really well, and even though I disagreed with many of his theories, he talked about that. Ben Danielson, member of the Kon-Tiki expedition. Maui Palmari, who at the time was doing the Maoris. And the list goes on with Donald Stanley Marshall. Georgia Reed, he's an island specialist. Joanne Vantover, Carol Ivory, Christina, and the list goes on and on. Eric. So I've had a unique experience of knowing these people and a very close relationship with them. And I think that I have a clearer view and understanding of Polynesian art because of that and because of my dear love of Polynesian. So we start off here with the famous Kino figure in Auckland. And when we released the film, it's quite dramatic because I had the museum closed for 8 hours. And the opening shot is this in the dark and then coming and putting light on it. So to me, nobody can really argue with this, but this is the greatest piece of tribal art that exists in the world. The greatest piece. There's no finer piece, in my opinion, and most people's opinion. And this is really where a lot of the artists have their ideas. I mean, to be very up close and personal with this is quite an amazing experience. There's been a lot said about it, a lot of papers been published on it. That was a photo I took just last week when I was there touring in Harold and Marines of Earth Program. So it is quite amazing, collected in the 1880s. And how it relates to some of the smaller figures, I have no idea. And also just think about a small island of New World, which is an atoll, and the size of the tree, and where did they get the wood for this? I mean, it's just an amazing piece of sculpture. So this, again, is sort of a poor picture. I took it off some iPhone photos that the producer did for me, and it's hard to see, but to me this is one of the greatest pieces of Maori art that exists in the world. And this is a chief's house, and again it's very poor, but what makes it really interesting is on the left hand side is a panel that was probably carved in the 15th century, and it depicts whales, a whale figure being hidden by a birdman figure, which is what we call a Naya figure. The piece was probably buried in a swamp during some type of warfare or sea. And in the 18th century, on the right-hand side, you've got an updated version, probably used with metal or definitely soft metal tools. And when you stand in front of it, it's quite amazing, the aesthetic. Someone uses your eyes to look at the stone car piece on the left right away. It's one of my favorite Maori objects. This is a And on this, a lot of people don't realize, well, how come the door is so low? That's because the chief was falling on his hands and knees. And then he probably the most used in the hospital. And so it's one of my favorite pieces that exists in Maori art. Again, these are very well published, these are Williams pieces. And actually, my good friends back there, Ed Roski and Peter Keller, we were just on a flight expedition in southern Laos, and we entered a lot of chief's houses. And the figure on the right side shows the position that one should be in, especially for a female, so your legs don't face outwards in disrespect to the village chief. And I remember one time, Ed and Peter, that after going to so many villages, that Leslie was there and said to me, "Mark, your legs are pointing towards the chief." And I said, you know, it's been a long day and whatever, so, but this really does show the situation. And these were collected in 1830 by Reverend William, and probably without a doubt the finest piece of pottery and sculpture that exists in the world. And this is basically a Venus. Okay. This is a very unusual Maori paddle that's in a French collection, probably about 1850, and relates to a few other known Maori objects with that type of curved paddle. And it was really a ceremonial paddle, not used by a chief, but by his attendants in a ceremonial committee. Quite beautiful aesthetic, with that exciting mind. Again, one of my favorite pieces in the British Museum, I have a similar piece, a Tahitian poncho, bark cloth, probably 1790, showing the lightning bolt design, and also the impressed fern leaf design. Very rare, very beautiful. Now, this was last week. It's a terrible photo. I was in a Cabo a few days ago, and many of us collectors, we love Polynesian furniture. And to me, this is one of the greatest pieces of Polynesian furniture that exists. And there's very little collection information on it. This thing is quite large, almost the size of a table. So for a Cook Island chief school, I would love to know more about it. Very, very, very beautiful. Another one of my favorite pieces, not published very often, a reputa, which is a Maori whale tooth pendant worn around the neck. And there's always been a lot of thought and theory on how these relate to the Hawaiian lady of Lao, tongue or whatever, and I'll leave that to the academics to debate. This is one of my favorite antiques. Last week I saw it in Chicago, snapped an iPhone photo of it. If I had too much, first of all, to hate Tiki Texan, I would choose this one. Really sort of a fierce Anglo-Panamanian. I believe it was found excavated near Murray Bay, but just so different from the rest of the Tiki's known. And this I put in there because of the fact that there's a lot of interest in fish hooks. As we know, in the last few years, a certain person in the Mideast was collecting fish hooks and that price is up. Going back. You really feel the aesthetic of Polynesia in one of these large hooks. You think about where these were made, whether on an atoll or a high island or whatever. I mean, they're just beautiful form and function. Nothing else like it. Very modernist in feel. And this is one of my favorite, one of my favorite objects, two of my favorite objects. My wife, who would probably die if she knew what was using this photo. But it's a Moai head in the Louvre. And to me, this represents the high point of Eastern art, rockabilly art. And on that, I'm going to do a plug, because the fact is breaking news. We're going to lend our collection in conjunction with Blackburn in a year and a half to 2 years, and it's actually going to go back to Eastern Ireland. So it will be the second time that a private collector has ever lent back to a Pacific culture. We did it once in Tonga with the Tonga National Museum in 1998. So it's going to open in LA, and we're going to move it to Eastern Ireland.
Thank you.
introduce Michael Hamson, who many of you know.
Mike Hamson is a good friend and a wonderful field collector of Oceanic tribal art, as is Chris here. And he's been at the show, I think, for almost 20 years or thereabouts. I think he has one of the very best websites and one of the great minds, and I think thinkers in the field. I give you Michael Hamson.
Thanks, Sam. Can everybody hear me well enough?
Yes.
Well, this is my face. This figure is from the Passoon area, which is a very, very remote area in the Kulon Peninsula of Marble Bay province. I'm sure, even though there's probably a lot of knowledgeable people here in Guinea Art, they might pinpoint where this actually comes from. It's a very remote and unknown culture. But to me, it's just a magnificent art object with all these, the way the creativity of the artist, where he combined all these different planes and curves and angles into a well-balanced, harmonic, ancestral figure. So to me, it's one of my all-time. This one is from the Masco collection that's now down in the LA County Museum of Art, and this is from the waking culture, one of my all-time favorite cultures. And we're all creatures of our own experiences, and I've spent a lot of my years in the waking area. And to me, this is just gorgeous because it is an actual figure, not just a head. The head is quite large, maybe 2 feet tall. One is a pre-contact figure carved with non-metal tools, but look how wonderful the volumes are. Look how crisp and clear the eyes are and the mouth. They have a certain clarity to it. And within New Guinea art, as Chris well knows, is that pigments and paint are extremely important because that's the magical element that turns a piece of wood into a living, breathing object. And rarely do you find an old object with beautifully rendered paint still intact. So this is one of my favorite things like that. It has a nice feel like it has this nice quality of calmness that you see in the eyes, but also a fierceness that you see in the mouth and the well spoken speech. Go ahead. This is a figure from the Torres Straits that was collected by Albert Haddon in roughly 1898. I love this piece because it's ancient. Even if it was collected in 1898, it at least has 100 years of field use on it, or a little bit there. It has a very organic, soft, curved form to it. I like how, if you look at the bottom leg that's broken off, it has a patina over the broken part. It shows you that that's over generations, even though it was broken, it still had this cultural import to it. It's still useful to the people who owned it. And it has a certain monumentality to it. I've never seen this piece in person, I've only seen it in books. I just kind of naturally assumed it was about 3 feet tall. It's actually 8 inches tall. It was a love charm. Like I said, we're kind of creatures of our own habits and experiences, and my experience in New Guinea, this is what I'm drawn to. I'm drawn to these very kind of archaic, brutal qualities in art. This is a Hanstein Mountain Gara mask. Pre-contact, it was carbonated for several hundred years, 300 or 400 years old. It was carbonated several hundred years old in the Jilguica collection. And to me, I just love this quality of this fierceness. And to me, one of the main characteristics I'm constantly looking for in Guinea art is this presence, this affecting presence that tells you that object, once alive, is still alive. This again is in the Jilguica collection, and an ancient sepik piece from the Blackwater River area. And what I love about sepik art, the best of sepik art, this one I think is carbon dated about 500 years old as well, is it has this combination of an archaic quality to it with supreme elegance and refinement. That's what I'm always looking for in a piece, this kind of a certain organic form, a certain good, strong volumes, powerful early forms, and then combined with very elegant, fine lines, like you can barely see the ridge of the nose and the sharpness of the shoulders, that little air, tiny space between where the upper arms just almost touch the knees. You know, that's what we're always looking for. We're looking for that combination of the rawness and the refinement. This is a classic lower cebic, I would say coastal cebic area, amulet figure. Again, it's only 5.5 inches tall. One of my favorite pieces because it exemplifies what you're really looking for in an early cebic figure. You're looking for this squatting power, you know, this enormous head that adjusts over the chest, recessed brow, recessed eyes, the overhanging brow. Look how thick the thighs are, thin arms, the buttocks juts out the back. So it has this kind of like coil spring effect to it, where it really has a sense of power. And look how tiny that little base is where it is. As figures like this become more recent, so maybe say this is from 1850 or 1860 or late 19th century. As cebic figures become more recent, 1910, 1920, 1930, there's a gradual kind of like stiffening of the pose where they're more upright, and all the way by 1960, they're kind of like a militaristic, you know, at attention pose. So, I mean, this is the far end of the extreme of the continuum of an early cebic figure. Again, you know, I'm just drawn to this is a Boykin mask from Malcolm Kirk in the Jellicoe collection. I'm just drawn to this kind of this rawness, this brutal quality of some of this art that's found in this culture that was really not that well known. It's in the mountains, the coastal mountains above the Cedric River. And again, it's just this kind of otherworldliness that I find so compelling and the best early community art. To me, this is a masterpiece of New Guinea art. Again, it has, even though it's fragmentary, it has that powerful pose with the legs really bent and coiledness to the power. Like it's at your service, ready to act. And in addition, look at all the different layers of paint on this thing. Above, on top of all the broken areas, and also there's layers of ancient traditional pigments and also Western. So to me, it shows that hundreds of years this piece had culturally useful and was valued by a particular culture for generations and generations. And even though this is a figure, look how the eyes are carved out like a mask and the mouth is carved out. It's as if the sculptor, the carver, wanted to make sure that this piece could breathe and see. Go back. Again, another unbelievable Boykin figure. This is just a culture that I'm really enamored with, and because it was not really well represented in a lot of museum collections. And then you come across something like this, which is so powerful, so striking, and it has that like the main quality that I'm talking about, this affecting presence that tells us that this piece was once lived, once alive. And this is not a mask, this is a thing. So the body has been reduced just to these two upper turning hooks. Again, you know, one of our colleagues that we all know is Joel Kooner, and he had this, he always had this saying that when he gets a piece, you want to see it, he want to judge it, it looks back at you. Does the piece look back at you? Does it have a soul? And to me, this is all about that. It's about that gaze, it's about that quality that looks back at you, that tells you that this is not just a piece of wood and cane and paint. This thing was alive. You know, it had a spiritual presence. We have to remember that these pieces were not representations of ancestral spirits. These were manifestations of ancestral spirits. So these things were considered alive. And the best pieces of New Guinea art, in my opinion, they still convey that fact to you. These were once alive. Again, another Boykin piece. I love this stuff. Again, it's not well known. It's a magnificent quality piece. This is a large wooden hammer mask that I'm sure even, you know, very seasoned, knowledgeable people of Oceanic art haven't seen something like this before. And so this is an ancient pre-contact stone carved piece, but look at the clarity of the facial expression. Look how smooth the volumes are on the forehead. This has a wonderful combination of light and shadow. So that has these curved areas that attract the light, juxtaposed against recessed areas that attract the dark shadow. So you have the combination of the light and dark that create the design beautifully. And so to me, it has this, what I call the quality of clarity. It's like an African, you guys know that Robert Harris Thompson wrote an essay called The Aesthetics of the Cool for Yorlis, which defines this combination of this juxtaposition of light and shadow. Again, clarity, my viewpoint, even though these two drums, these are two hand drums from the Torricelli Mountains in the West Cedar Province of Papua New Guinea, in my, you know, clarity is about trying to convey sculptural form as simply as possible, as few sculptural forms as possible. And drums are kind of a celebratory object often, so they have normally in most different cultures in the beginning. They're hourglass shaped, they have a handle in the middle, they have maybe creatures on either side of the handle, they have lots of carved design, and they're a bit over the top. But look how austere these two drums are. Paired down to the absolute minimal sculptural element. Just the drum, the barrel of the drum, and this classic, iconic West Cedar cook form of the animal. Now here's some field photos. They asked me to show some field photos in. This guy, his name is Hans. He's about 80 years old. And this is from Umboy Island, which is part of the Golden Gulf area. Oh, go back to the bowl. I'm just saying this because this bowl on the left is probably from 1980, and the one on the right is from 1880. People are always asking me, well, how can you tell how old something is? You just have to realize that everything has a style, just like cars or furniture or whatever. And if you get to know an object type very well, you can judge the style as pretty much under 10 years how it gradually changes from the one on the right, from 1880, to the one on the left in 1980. Now, this guy's name is Paul, and he's holding in his right hand a bone comb and on a little ancestral figure in his left hand. And one of the benefits of collecting the field is that you get kind of insights about how objects were used that are kind of contrary to often you might see or think in a book or something. Like the object in his right hand is a comb, you would think it's a hair ornament or something like that, but in fact this was used for healing. It was considered the most powerful object in the community to heal physical illnesses. And even though these people lived next to a health clinic, they always went to Paul when they had symptoms.
In which community is this gentleman from?
That's in the Boylan area, it's a soy area. And that's the actual shrine inside his house in the Boylan area that shows you how these pieces were actually kept. I don't know if you can see the Boylan, the comb, a little bit here, in the very back, very eroded partial mass. There's sort of magical rocks, pieces of magical coral, magical bark, and even this strange bone object in the foreground with two eye holes. He called it the bones of a dwarf, not an actual dwarf. But they refer to these little ancestral figures with the squatting figures that we've been looking at, they call them dwarfs. So this was supposedly like a living, actually ancestral spirit. Have to go back. No, go back. There, that guy. Okay, this is the bowl. This is an old man from one of the Shooting Islands holding just a regular food bowl. But this bowl is so old that it had its own history and its own name. So just don't think just because it's a utilitarian object, it doesn't have that spiritual presence. So this bowl had a history, its own personal name, was considered part of the community. And it's just a wooden bowl. Okay. And another field photo, this is from the Yanguru Awakening people. And I just wanted to say how the close connection between people and these ancestral spirit figures. You can see how happy this guy is with his little figure, and how it almost resembles him or something like that. And the two pieces, like I said, had names, had personal histories, were treated as part of the family. That's why when I'm looking at an old figure, I'm always looking to see if the ears appear or if the nose appears. Because they would adorn the piece like they were adorned. These figures, these objects, are powerful objects. I consider them almost like a weapon in the sense that they can do you great help. They can be powerful for the benefit of you, for your protection, for getting food in the forest or in the garden or something like this. But just like a weapon, if you don't treat it right, it could go back and hurt you. And this particular figure I found on Tolokiwa Island, which is a remote island in the Golden Gulf area. And I bought it from this old gal here. And she said, well, you know, my husband, this used to be owned by my husband, but then he unexpectedly died. So she gave it to her son, and he unexpectedly. So then she threw it Hollywood swamp until I came along. So I'm just trying to say these figures have both positive and negative energy.
And now you're coming to an end.
No, let's go back to the wine spatula. Okay, this is the second last slide. In the sense of the wine spatulas, a lot of people have these, are kind of maybe considered more utilitarian objects, kind of decorative. But this is from the Kaufmann Bay area. And in Kaufmann Bay, the lime spatulas were the most important material objects for this building. They didn't have figures, they didn't have masks, they had lime spatulas. And I remember hearing stories from the old man who told me that when only the big chiefs owned these particular lime spatulas. And when they were going to have a meeting and going to discuss important matters, all the chiefs would gather, and they the head chief, when he wanted to start the meeting, would rattle his lime spatula in the board, and everybody would calm down and pay attention. Then they'd all discuss these important community matters, and then the head chief, would pass his lime spatula to all the other chiefs, and as they grasped that lime spatula, that was their way of saying, I agree, I'm signing on to this agreement. That's what they call it that. So it was an extremely important object, and sometimes you don't know that, you think it's just a lime spatula. This is the quirky little object. It just reminds me that in New Guinea, there's 800 cultures, very few have been studied, especially the art. And this is from the Rawlinson Range in an interesting club.
Thank you.
Christina is the curator in charge of the Young Museum.
Migrations because some of the objects that really interest me are objects that are kind of connective tissue between two cultures or two moments in time. This is an ancient prehistoric mortar that was found in the Dang province, and it obviously been discovered by people there, and this happens with a number of the prehistoric stones. In the beginning, they're not familiar with the forms, that they're not connected to these pieces culturally, but they find their own uses for them. So the recorded use for this is, for some of these mortars, grain mortar was placed in them, and they were used for women to help with infertility, or they were used to help help with garden, what was called garden magic, or help fields become more productive. I won't pause too long because I know that Carolyn has one of these navigational figures in her slides as well. This is in the Dian collection, but you might not have seen it on view very often. But it was collected by Captain Pitchfield, who had a ship that traveled to Micronesia in the early 20th century. And this was used to help navigators in Micronesia. And this is particularly important because it still contains a barnacle that you see wrapped in fiber at the bottom, and all the domes still contain that. This is often referred to as a lintel. It's in the collection of the Auckland Museum. You didn't see it in Mark's slides, but it's probably known to you. But again, it's one of these objects that tells us a little bit about what might have been ancient Maori carving and how those styles were moving across the Pacific. And it's called a lintel, but now generally just called a carving because it is carved on both sides, and so the exact use of it is not known. But with this amazingly compelling central figure, and then what I believe to be kind of the Maya figures at the sides. And I also wanted to just, I have two slides that also remind you that there are a lot of people working in the museums that to me are also important to helping us enjoy and study these pieces, including a number of indigenous curators, including Chanel Clark, who is pictured on the left, and in this case the carving is going back to the community of origin for a special exhibit. This is a book that we have on view at the museum right now in the Royal Wine Fieldwork and the World Lady exhibition. And it's one of my favorites because you can see that the tropic bird feathers that are dark in color have been knotted in a particular way that makes them sit upright. So if you go more and more, you have an incredible effect. And you know, all of the cloaks would have been just stunning when worn, of the light effects and the feathers, some of the feathers, the moa, the pinnacle chicken feathers are, you know, most iridescent, and then you have just the vibrant red and yellow colors that must have been incredibly impressive. And here you have Marcus Margon on the left, Kamala Prey, Betty Cam in the rear, and then Sheila Conan in the light-colored shirt, who is so important to our project because we have to try to identify the feathers and do a better job. It's one of the things we try to do each project is like do a better job of documenting the works and determining exact species and that sort of thing. And I wanted to feature a few textiles because for me, I'm constantly awed by textiles in Oceania. This is a piece of armor from West New Guinea. And this orchid fiber and cane work is really impressive. If you go over one slide, you can see this is the cane detail. And this would have, you know, been protective in nature, but if you go back, Dave, you can see that orchid fiber, actually, is there one more after? No, okay, so you're right. The orchid fiber has actually, there's bark fiber has been wrapped with orchid fiber. So, you know, it's incredibly detailed work and just so fine in quality. And attached there were also cuscus and bird skins, but that's what was hanging from the top. Again, a West New Guinea orchid fiber and fiber vellum, and most of you are familiar with vellum, which are just ubiquitous in New Guinea and carry everything from babies to cell phones and school books. But again, and this wonderful aesthetic use of the yellow orchid fiber wrapped around the string to create these miracle bands. You can see the detail there. This wonderful Salos mask, again, great work with the cane that has all these different planes, and there's a detail that shows you know, these areas where the artist had to combine the different components that had been created. And this was field photographed by the Forge in 1960, so that we have some sense of the structure that extended beyond the mask that is, of course, often not collected with them. And that's another kind of side point about the aesthetics. We are seeing the fragments, but they're still stunning. And you can go quickly. One of my favorite pieces of our cloth is the Oscar Island Museum, where I formerly spent a long time, and just an absolutely stunning piece of our cloth. And I have a few more. Another, Mark showed you a poncho. This one has obviously hand painted designs and a clothing form that was an adapted form, but then completely transformed with the artistry of Pacific bark cloth makers and painters. And a wonderful Lake Santani marl in the Leon with these prominent sawfish. And this was in the Paul Mayer collection and exhibited in his exhibition, and has just a wonderful composition and an array of forms and figures. And there's always a little discussion about what sits outside the frame.
Thank you very much. This is Christian Kaufmann, who was a former curator for a long time at the Boswell Museum. And where are you now? And he spoke at the DeYoung on Thursday. It was a wonderful day. So please go ahead.
Good morning, everybody. Do you hear me? Is that what is the mic working?
Yes. 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 You have more volume.
Yes. Well,
keep the mic, please. Keep the mic.
Keep the mic. Okay, is that better? Closer, please. Closer to the mic. this, the figure you see on the screen, that was my first, well, what should I say, discovery. In my first internship at the Boston Museum, I was given the task to classify, to order a collection that was mixed up. And then I found this figure. That really took my first, was my first step into UBR. It comes from the UL River, Loris CP. And you see it's a male figure standing, has traits of a crocodile and additional heads. It's transparent, it has all sorts of structures. It's dynamic. And for me, it's showing the potential of transformation, which a lot of the best CPR has. The second thing which put me into real contact with the public, including doctors and artists, was Cova. Okay, I went there for my thesis and studied how they made pots, how they decorated pots, it's chip card, and traditionally they added also modeled, this is a modeled Vienna head, so it's basically a pot, but opening on top and below to put it on a stick. Probably amongst the former is the most personal way. I explained already on Thursday briefly. It's the thing a potter has to do everything from making the pot to finishing the decoration before then drying it for firing within 24, 36 hours because the clay is hardening. So it's the most personal expression of what a man can achieve as an artist. Some proud decoration from the Kogodala, western province in Papua, collected by Paul Leeds in 1930, was lost in our storeroom. This half of the storeroom, and thanks to Anthony Crawford, who did this later book, he wanted to have everything photographed, and then we found the evidence again and put it back again. So, since we know what it is, mixture of plant material with feathers, and then you imagine that was sitting on the war crab in front. The walking room crab, sorry. Bent Coast Island in Vanuatu has these wonderful traditions of mat making. This is women's art. It's matting on your upper leg, sitting for hours. Usually it's diagonal mapping. You start in the center, then go to the fringes. And some traditions have ornaments wrapped into, and then some have ornaments wrapped into and reserved by motifs put on top. So this is the stencils put on top, wrap it in, and then put it into a bath with some natural pigments, nowadays also with modern pigments, but that was collected in 1911 by British Spider on his 2 years amongst people of New Hebrides and Banks Islands. Used for mortuary ceremonies, but also used for right wealth exchange. So in fact, mortuary ceremonies, bodies were wrapped up in such mats. Maybe. Highly esteemed master. I mean, this was it was a valuable thing, not just the day. Again, Penn Coast Island, two chupan masks collected in 1928 by two young Europeans who turned the film where the last scene was turned in a studio in Paris by Panelists. But apart from that, was the young people wanted to make a name of themselves, they also were serious collectors, amongst which these two masks now in the Geneva Museum of a tradition, the Jukban, which was for more than a generation, was a hidden tradition in, on the island in Vanuatu. So no longer performed, or even more than for 60 years, until knowledge was passed down from one guardian to the other and to the exchange payments made to keep the tradition alive. And the ceremonies then were made only for people of the village, not for outsiders. tub shell. 5 centimeters.
Oh, 10 centimeters.
Was a mystery collected by Felix Speisel in 1912. He did this one not to show, which was traveling scouting actually in Gorilla in 1996. And we had this bird alone. And then we learned after a while, some elderly people came and told us it was used in a norm in the front of the land going through the hole, tied to the front of high-grade men on the land. So just imagine the land with this going in before. How the shape is because it was a bit of a problem of getting the seepest papers. How we made it. Another unexpected object from southern Vanuatu. There is a small island, Futuna, off Tana, with Polynesian speakers, with a Polynesian language. This stone, carved from coral stone, coral rock figure, is in the Australian Museum. Was donated by a Captain Welsh in 1884. He was working for the Mission Society, and he had to put to sea, well, he dropped into sea the surveys from the Marae. Except this one, I don't know whether it was himself or the missionary who told him to bring it to the Australian Museum, where he was sitting on a shelf, unacknowledged, until we got it out for the Vanuatu show. It is quite stunning. And you can imagine there were more of these things on the rise. So probably it was some sort of a canoe, for the sake of canoe, with figures sitting in. We don't know more. My last slide, Tivaatu again. And one very special Tivaatu. It's the one in the Cologne Museum, Bartholomew Museum, where it arrived in 1913 from Captain Jeschke, Karl Jeschke, who was a German small ship captain, but by the way, he had a wife, but from the war. So he spent some time between 1910 and 13 between his shipping missions as a captain. And I think he also tried to hide away in 1910 from the colonial war going on the coral. And he collected oral traditions, the remaining oral traditions on the coral island in those years. And donated finally this figure to the museum in Cologne. So it is the last, it's one of the smaller ones, approximately 70 or 80 centimeters high. It's one of the last figures that was given to him by the local family, probably of his wife there, with the knowledge that it had. It's important for the art history of Oceanic R2, because in 1923-24, Ernst Butler, from the curator from the Frankfurt Museum, started to write a book, a first book, The Anthropology of Art in the Pacific. And he was married to his first wife, a professional photographer. And they took a very good photograph of this figure, published in his art book, published late 24, early 25, where he describes this piece as an artwork, not in the anthropological sense, as an artwork, and opposes its way of reduced form to the masks from neighboring islands. So he makes quite a lot of about the interpretation. I don't want to go into all the details. Thank you.
If you come back from Glasgow, we'll ask you to speak for a longer time and give your brain some more. Now, former curator at the Metropolitan Museum, Eric Kjellgren.
Thank you very much. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
All right, very good. Yeah, so when Dave first asked me to join the panel, he gave me what I thought was a somewhat contradictory assignment. He sort of said, pick 12 pieces of oceanic art, you know, if you could have any 12 pieces, which would they be? But you can't pick ones that are well-known and widely published. The difference being that many of my favorite works are well-known. work of some of my favorite, but perhaps a bit lesser known, certainly in the U.S., works of Oceanic art. I actually did my doctoral research in Australia, and I thought I would show a few examples of some of my favorite contemporary Aboriginal paintings. This is an example of one of the very earliest boards, so-called paintings, being called boards because they were done on cardboard, from a community called Papanya in the center of Australia. This was actually the origin of contemporary Western Desert painting. Many of you are probably familiar with these. They're often referred to sort of colloquially as dot paintings because they're often very elaborately dotted. But in fact, in dot paintings, the dots are mostly decorative. What matters and what really puts the story and the power behind the image are actually the elements that appear among the dots. And during the very early years when these paintings first arose, artists sort of were experimenting with how to show aspects of their dreams, of their traditional histories that describe the origin of the landscape and the ancestral beings who shaped it. And so many of these early ones, you actually don't get an awful lot of dots, but you get these forms that kind of floating against a solid background, and the skin is much more very early as years, by 1971. These paintings emerge, as I say, from a community called Montana, which is where many years ago, and Aboriginal people from the local area had been forcibly resettled by the government. It was a time of great sort of despair and poverty in this community, and yet the old men basically brought forth, again, with the help actually of an Australian school teacher, these aspects of their ancestral art and their dreams, and really gave birth to a whole new movement within modern art, and this is among the earliest ones. I should say that you're actually seeing it somewhat oversized there. The original is about as big as this computer. As the, you can go there someday, as the Central Desert Acrylic Movement sort of grew, a number of other communities started painting. This is an example actually from a community called Balgo, in actually part of Western Australia. And it is by an artist who I think is very much underappreciated in the world of contemporary acrylics, Amy Kimi Noorai. She didn't live a very long life. She died, she was born in 1955, died in 1992. Left only a handful of paintings, but some of them, to my mind, are among the most dynamic and sort of fabulous of, you know, modern desert acrylics. Makes wonderful use of color and composition. This painting here, which actually doesn't really show, it looks a little bit like a flower in the upper left. This is actually a group of women sitting around in a court in the sacred site, and other sacred places are indicated on this. She has just an absolutely marvelous use of color, as many of the contemporary acrylic artists do. They can take colors, you know, neon green, neon purple, neon pink, so that if you put it up on your wall as your main colors to make you run screaming from the room, and combine them in something that are just, to my mind, very beautiful. This one is in the National Gallery of Australia. It's an early example of a work by this one artist. Next. This is a more, if you want to say, a traditional Aboriginal painting. This is an example of a contemporary painting from Arnhem Land in the northern part of Australia, for those of you who might not be familiar with it. Artists in this region originally painted on the walls of caves and rock shelters, also actually on the undersides of the bark that they used to line the ceilings of temporary structures they built to protect themselves in the rainy season. This is by actually one of my favorite and I think very much underappreciated Arnhem Land artists. A man named Barayal Najibarak. His dream actually was lofty because he was a very tall man. I actually had the privilege of meeting him once a number of years ago. He could easily have probably put a basketball in the hoop without having to jump. But in my mind, he's one of the most gifted artists. Most of his subjects consist of both animals, as you see here, and human figures. While many Arnhem Land bark paintings, to my mind, although the figures are quite animated, they're also running and screwing, that's what they do. The figures, most of them kind of sort of look like they're stuck to the canvas. It's going to be very static. His look to me like they're floating, zero gravity. Like all of a sudden, you know, somebody pulled the bottom out from under and everything went flying around. I had actually a great deal of trouble finding a good example of this. His works are actually not widely published. He has been recognized in underappreciated. Began actually his early life painting on the walls of caves and rock shelters, and then, like many of the senior Aboriginal artists in the area, came later in life and works for the fine art market. Next. This is a work. Actually, if I was giving this talk in Australia and people said, you know, you have to pick obscure works of art that I would be disqualified. This is in fact a painting by an artist named Robert Thomas, a painter from a completely different region within contemporary Aboriginal painting, the East Kimberley. This is actually the region in which I did my doctoral research, and I was very privileged to know Robert Thomas. He just had a remarkable talent for color and composition, often made these very spare compositions like you see here, a little bit reminiscent of some modern abstractionism. In fact, the National Gallery of Australia, they had a painting by Mark Rothko, and reputedly, one time when Robert Thomas was visiting and going through the modern art gallery, he pointed at the painting by Rothko and he said, "That bugger paints like me." But at any rate, it's just one of my favorite arts. Now we're moving to the New Guinea. I'm actually to one of my favorite works from Western New Guinea. Photographs don't really do this piece justice. This is, as I think a number of you can probably see, a core of our figure from the Gilbert Bay. And I'm not called gender Wasi Bay area. House the spirit of an ancestor. This particular one is in the World Museum in Rotterdam, and it is just absolutely remarkable. They actually put the second shot made. I want to go back to the first, I guess. This has just most of them they have a sort of blocky sort of square shed. This one you took it and you stretched it out like a piece of toffee. And it has these wonderful old kind of pretzel-like arms that it holds in front of it. And it's only about a foot high, but it has an enormous presence. I think actually Michael Lee, when you were talking about when you look at a piece and it looks back at you, this is one of the ones that does it for me. I was 7 years ago at the Metro, when I was at the Metropolitan trying to put together a show on Unique Art. And I got the great privilege of visiting it over the collections there. And I made some kind of notations in my thing next to the catalog. I was like, one star if it was okay, 2 stars if it was very good. My notes on this one simply said a screaming masterpiece. One of my personal fantasies. Next, that's the same object from the front. This actually, I am now worked actually at the University of St. Thomas in Minnesota, both teaching and I run a small museum there dedicated to Osmond art, called the American Museum of Osmond Art. This is primarily the missionary collection from Catholic missionaries who work in the Osmond region. This is my favorite piece from our collection there. Similar in some respects to the one, Chris, that you showed. Again, one of these great Osmond shields with a sort of flying fox motif. And those very abstracted motifs that you can see almost like they're weaving around in the middle of a composition. There are stylized flying foxes, say, a type of fruit bat. And this one just says, to my mind, a lovely rhythm and composition. This is a mask that I had seen published before, and actually had for the last summer, the chance to see first half for the first time. Another piece that no photograph could really do justice to, it's a mask from the Murek Lakes region, lower the Sibu area of Papua New Guinea. It actually looks even more imposing from the front. This is a mask, actually a rare instance where we actually know the carver of it, a man named Wiki, and the masked person's name was Wine. Said to house the spirit of that had caused a lot of sickness in one village, that was in trading to another. You're seeing it in profile here. And again, it is very hard for this photograph to really gain an idea of what presence this thing has. And if you stand right in front of it, it sort of has its eyes and nose, and the nose is slightly tilted akimbo, actually, like some of those great Boylan masks that you were showing. And this piece looks back at you so hard you almost don't want to be in stare. It's in the National Museum in Papua New Guinea. Was lent to them actually to an exhibition of Sibu Guard held in Canberra last year. I know many of you probably have been to the European Sibu show. This one was held in Australia and had some wonderful works in it as well. This is a piece actually from the Uruze Museum in Bremen. This is also from the Sibu region on the middle Sibu River. Was a gable mask. It actually was originally been on the gable or facade of a ceremonial house. Representing the supernatural being associated with it. And if you look at the bottom, and again, this sadly is in storage in Bremen. If you look at the bottom, what look like those sort of white areas, these are actually the nostrils of the piece, and its nose is kind of flare up. So it kind of has this nostril pierced through, the mouth just kind of does a loop on the bottom, the face almost kind of half bird, half human. It's really a remarkable object. You're seeing it, you're probably just slightly over life size. Again, one that when I was actually historically quite well known, but in a rather remote location, even for Oceanic Park. This is a very famous piece on the Mashala Bay on the north coast of New Guinea, powerful ancestral being. And this one is actually in a very early photograph, an early document, and it belongs actually to a mission museum in Wuppertal. It is displayed there. It's about 12 or 2 meters high, so it's, you know, you're seeing it well under life size here. And it has this very dynamic paint and just a motion to the body of it that most things from that area to my mind don't have. Often my favorite works from different traditions are something that kind of embodies the stuff that kind of takes it a little further or does something a bit unconventional. This, to my mind, is a lot more sort of movement and animation than those. Again, this thing is huge. You're seeing it smaller than it actually is in real life. Displayed in a somewhat odd manner, I actually cropped it for this. It's a sort of circular tube of acrylic, which I've tried to crop out here, in kind of a circular room with a number of other works. There's some other marvelous works from the North Coast of New Guinea in that collection. It looks, though, a little bit like the transporter deck on Star Trek. So the museum architecture, in this case, somewhat distracts from the pieces, but the pieces are very much worth seeing. So beam me up, Scotty, for the next one. I promise you I did not confer with my guests. also one of my favorites, we'll just pass over it very briefly, at Rapasu. These are a group of works from New Britain, a large island just to the north of New Guinea and part of the modern nation of Papua New Guinea. These are headdress effigies. These are enormous. The one on the left-hand side is about 15 or 20 feet high. These are displayed in the central atrium of the Boylan Museum in Braden, actually where that gable mask I showed you a couple of frames ago was from. And again, 15, 20 feet high. Much of Oceanic art has this sort of, you know, very majestic, very controlled, very sort of serious quality. These, in my mind, are a bit comical looking. Likely represent spirits associated with a dance called the English Day Dance, because it takes place during the day. The Chachet mining, something that has not been made for probably about 100 years. There are some much better known ones in Hamburg, and we see that these in Bremen are among my favorites, in part because they have slightly sort of more Swedish quality, if you want to call it that. Again, it's very hard to get an idea of scale, but you imagine going almost all the way up to where those lights are on the ceiling. That's about how high the one on the left is. You can see actually it going past the second story of the museum atrium there. Next, this is a figure. We've seen a number of examples of figures from Nukubora. This is actually from another of the Polynesian islands, an island called Nukumanu. A very different style from Nukubora figures, which have this very sort of fine curves. This one I just really like. It's kind of blockiness, and it has a very sort of brooding quality to it. This also is a very large one. It's about as tall and as wide as one of these speakers here. It's in the Grassi Museum in Leipzig. Again, a collection which has some wonderful things in it, maybe not quite as well known. And it also maintains actually its original waist cloth that it had. And not all actually of the, you can see it wrapped around the waist. Not all actually of the wear on that waist cloth is ethnographic in nature. At least according to the current curator, when this used to be displayed on an open platform, occasionally people would decide to check to see if it had been edited by the missionaries. And in fact, apparently the answer is no. So some of that works for visitors kind of having a look. Next. This is the final object here. This is a modern greenstone pendant of a particularly beautiful type of greenstone, or Boylan, as the Maori call it. Said to sort of represent or resemble the feathers of a bird's pigeon. This object is in the Auckland Museum, which has so many masterpieces of Maori sculpture and other sculpture, including those wonderful Tonga figures that Mark showed, the large Kimura figure, as well as a number of the great masterworks of Maori sculpture. But things like this are almost overlooked. I first saw this piece actually in 1984. It was part of the Te Maori show, which again had some absolutely stunning masterworks of Maori sculpture. But this is one of the very first pieces of Oceanic art that absolutely blew my mind when I saw it. And even though I also go to Auckland to see all the marble sculpture, I never fail to figure out to find the case where this is in and just gaze at it for minutes on end. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
current, I think, Columbus is in that right, but I'm not sure. I'm not a gemologist.
I think so.
Yeah.
I'm so glad that our, now our next speaker, who's fighting off a broken leg or recovering from a broken leg, is going to show us that he's got a great eye. You know him locally, our favorite Sam Singer. And I'm glad he gets a chance to talk, because I asked him to be a moderator, and I haven't allowed him to moderate much. But Sam, when I said to help me be a moderator, he said, I'm from Berkeley, and I don't understand that word.
I'm going to speak very briefly. I want to make a couple of comments before we go through the slides. First of all, it was 15 or 17 years ago that my wife Sharon and I got turned on Oceanic Art. It was by Michael Hamson. It was this very show, and I think shows like this are particularly important for scholars, for collectors, for people interested in tribal primitive art premieres, and so I'm glad to see so many of you here and show such interest. One of the things that I tried to do, we tried to do things that both Sharon and I love, was to look for things, again, sort of following Michael's thoughts about that. Clarity, form, elegance, menace, power, and so sometimes they don't have to be big, they can be small. The example here is a poplin gulf cone that's just outstanding. It also follows the form of the nunus, which are carved in dreams, and I think this cone is very reflective of that as well, a very elegant thing. Next slide, please.
Microphone, sir?
I'm sorry?
Microphone.
Oh, I'm not, can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
I think we're all okay. This is a fantastic Banks Island piece, probably is off the top of a panel or some sort of handle. And for me, it reflects many of the things that I like so much and Sharon likes so much in Polynesian art, Oceanic art. The simplicity of form, the tucked in body, the elongated face, and just a beautiful piece of sculpture. Excellent. You know, personal decoration is really, I think, underappreciated in Oceanic art. This is a fantastic piece, something that John 3D, this came out of the 3D collection, and I think it sort of says it all. It's just beautiful. I don't think I need to narrate it. Next one. This is I'm in love with this Maori sculpture. This is something that we saw in Paris a couple of years ago. Ancient and actually this picture which I took it really reflects its actual color, almost purple. And it's an erosion in its power, its clarity, and I'm mad about its hand composition there, is something that we just love. The clarity and beauty in this hook, and I'm not drawn to hooks very much, but because of the human body going into, before I even say flying fox, going into grass and mudfish, and the transformation of this piece and the clarity of it is absolutely outstanding. I wanted to point this out because I don't also think people give, you'll see the piece we just talked about right there, but I want to point out it's not a great picture of this wall, this west wall. I think it's really one of the great pieces of Oceanic art. It's powerful, it's got clarity. It's as modern as anything you've seen in the museum of modern art. And with that comment, I'd also like to say, you know, I think that the arts that we all enjoy here should get as much attention and interest as contemporary and modern art. And so I hope that you all become acolytes and continue to spread the word. But that is a real masterpiece, that goal of Oceanic art. Next piece, please. I'm nuts about this Castle Bay mask. I think it's a very powerful piece, and since I'm not good about dating things, but I would assume this is from the previous century, two centuries back now, I think it's fascinating how it possesses many of the elements of an Art Deco sculpture, and it's powerful and very menacing at the same time. And the patina is magnificent. Talk about Michael Hamson showed the cones earlier. These are three different Boykin cones. And I think it's fascinating to see, Sharon and I also really like to look at things in groups, and I think that's what makes shows like this really fun, is to look at things in groups and compare and contrast them, and see how artists each approach the subject with a different the same body, but with different eyes for them. And from the one on the far left, and then the one on the far right, and then the very exceptionally eccentric one-eyed comb in the middle. But all of them are magnificent Boykin combs. Next, please. Also, small things are really magnificent. And sometimes they come, I think, in Oceanic art, and perhaps in other trademarks as well. Things come out, there'll be a big burst of them. And for a while, there were a number of morophies, which is magic charms in the Papuan Gulf. And I think these were really two particularly great examples for the following reasons. One is the use of negative space on the left. It's just an absolutely whole being there without any need to draw it at the bottom. And on the one on the far right, the exact opposite of that, where they're rarely drawn with this much detail, and it's almost like a gopi or a spirit board on a moropod, which I just think is magnificent. We love this declaration. This is something that, we think is very indicative of really the power and charm and surrealism of Oceanic art. Probably a seated coconut carved with, for maybe perhaps a big man or ceremony, but personal decoration, quite wonderful. I'm sorry I wasn't able to get a picture of this because there's a lot more color to it. Anything else? I can't remember. This both these pieces. The one on the left is a beetle mortar from the Solomon Islands, and it's a double figure, a twin figure. And the flow of the shape of the arms, which perhaps not as clear as they ought to be, and the legs, and the duality of these pieces is really magnificent. It's just a gem. And the piece on the right, I believe also is Solomon Islands, and it's not absolutely known what it uses for, but its form and shape and patina is like the most deeply waxed sheen wood imaginable from use over time. Anything else? There's a nice contrast as well, out of magic containers, as a piece of bone and carved. We also resemble, in our opinion, houseboats for house cameras, and you can see from left to right, again, different treatments of the same piece, and how wonderful, even though the one on the far left is sort of particularly fabulous, it's nice to see the treatment on the other two as well. I was so happy that Eric talked about Australian art because Chiringas, I think, are absolutely, there's a number of them at the show, are absolutely underappreciated and are really some of the most magnificent pieces of tribal or national. This is a particularly wonderful one. It's incredibly elaborate, more elaborate than most. And its interconnectivity and its reflection of, I think Keith Haring must have seen these and ripped off the others. It's literally the same thing, but I think as much as I like Keith Haring, I find these much more charming as Sharon. Anything else? That's me. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing the enthusiasm of the collector with us. And now, last but not least, except maybe in height, we have my favorite surfer and dear friend, Carolyn Yacoe, and she's a filmmaker who's made educational films on Micronesia and curated exhibitions and other wonderful things. Carolyn.
Thank you so much, Dave. Is this working?
Yes.
Could you speak up a little?
Aim the mic this way. There you go.
Thank you again, the audience.
No, it's not better.
Micronesian art, along with all Pacific art, past and present, really reflects and expresses the beliefs of the people, their histories, their culture, their interactions with the spirit and that's what really intrigues me. The Micronesian eyes are very small, but the art can be monumental. Like this figure from Eric's former home, the Metropolitan Museum of Art. It's known as a delicate figure, and it's found on a men's tablet in Palau. There are two explanations for this figure. One is that she represents female protection and healing, and the other that she represents a promiscuous woman and has been placed in positions as a warning to other Palau women. And that's a common aspect of Palau art, that it teaches the morals and social norms of the society. Next, please. Whatever you think, whatever you believe you attach to the figure, there's no question about her aesthetic qualities. The abstracted, simple lines and the angular face are very typical, for example, of classic Micronesian art. Fast forwarding to 2004, here is a contemporary Baha'i, and again, you can see the Dilakai today. Can you pull your up there? Back. All the applicants on the actual are because these islands are so small and so remote. We've talked about Palau, the Bay, Yacoe, the canoes, and the dust figure. We really have to chuck and other. Well, there's a, up in the top of Chuck is more on islands, and then Pompey, Nicaragua, which we all know about now, and also King Morangi, and then on to the Marshalls, one of my favorites. And this is another canoe, great adornments, but in this time it's paying homage to the birds. And I think of Michael's comment about clarity of the elegance of form in this beautiful canoe-style adornment, which honors the birds. And the birds are extremely important because they help to locate a fish, which is a primary protein in these subsistence cultures. Next, please. This is, to the best of my knowledge, one of the only masks in my collection. It's an iconic face with eyebrows which represent the wings of frigate birds, and it's found in Satawan, one of the Mortlock Islands in Chud. And it is believed to help protect the breadfruit crop, which is again another subsistence food for the island of Zero, so it's extremely important that it be fertile and that it's protected from top foods. These masks would usually be placed on the huts where the breadfruit is, the houses are breadfruit, but also next food. They would be danced on the beach, and that must have been quite exciting to see those big heavy masks in there to ward off top foods.
The originals of these are oversized, yes, and they're large.
But there are small ones too that were placed on the storage. But the original one in London are much larger ones. You all know this figure, and I'm very honored that three people have chosen a piece from Micronesia as one of their favorites. The smaller ones, like Christian was talking about, I believe are connected with the world, ancient deities, and ancestors. But they all share this incredible shape and minimalized abstract movement. Going from the ceremonial to the Mediterranean world, this is a simple coconut braid from the Mediterranean, also in Pompeii, but its elegant lines and aesthetic qualities make it look for it. Slides are the navigation charts from the Marshall, also from the Marshall Islands.
not questions. The lectures were so definitive, we may not, but we're taking questions, and we will, we know that some of you have to leave, and we once again want to thank all of our panelists.